Brothers and sisters, I thank you all. And I thank the hostess, the president of the Holistic University. I thank my hostess also. I thank all the people with whom I have acquaintance this time in Paris. And I find that people with whom I am acquainted are especially favorable and very considerate to me. A noble biography spoken in a noble place has an ennobling effect. A personality like Pythagoras is one among those who live through eternity. According to the heights of wisdom he has touched and the self-sufficient nature of his equipment of ancient wisdom, which is sufficient enough to instruct the people of any century, and an unswerving discipline of oneself and others. These are the main things that characterize the great light Pythagoras. His sense of discipline was so much. It was one of the main causes of unhappiness in his career, which I will also touch in the course of our considering the biography of the great soul. But if we consider through centuries and through various nations, people of such a self-sufficient wisdom are rare. We can very easily say that such people ennoble the human birth. He was born in a considerably noble family in Greece in about 300 years before Christ. And as a student, he was understood as a genius. And he was trained in the fundamentals of ancient wisdom in his own country. And as he grew up in age, thirst for wisdom also developed with him. And he has gradually developed a desire to go around the world in his course of the quest for wisdom. He could visit many places, undergo the spiritual training of many countries, some of which are known to history and some still unknown. The known aspect of his biography is very little when compared with the unknown aspect, which can be suspected by legend and tradition. And he especially had his spiritual training in Egypt. After his finishing his training in Greece, he went to Egypt and lived there at least for 10 years. And he was with very great spiritual gurus of the age. And all of them were really feeling a joy to see such a prodigy as Pythagoras. In the course of his learning, he has learned things of ancient wisdom. For example, about the mysteries of birth and death, about the secrets of cosmogenesis and anthropogenesis, and about the science of the origin of the elements, and the various branches of mathematics. Of course, sciences like mathematics were of a different nature in those days than they are now. They were rather symbolic in their nature. Each subject indicated something symbolic about the creation. This is what we understand when we read his passages about his theory of numbers. And he had all the advanced knowledge about the science of health, the science of diet, physical training and mental training, and the science of architecture and the various arts like music and poetry. It is said whenever he spoke in an epigrammatic way, and he had a very great command over language, so that he used the sentence and the sound also to inculcate the subject in the mind of the reader. It is said when he spoke, his voice was the cause of initiations to his disciples. Sentences which were not understood by his disciples from the scriptures and the ancient books, which they could not understand when they studied themselves, could understand without explanation when Pythagoras uttered those sentences. One of the many legends about Pythagoras. It may be true because it is true with many people. The very voice makes people understand things, and the syntax he used to explain many sciences in a wonderful way. And afterwards, when he completed his training in Egypt, it seems he returned to his native country, Greece, once again, made a noble, comfortable residence in near Athens. And he had his discourses and lessons given to his groups of disciples. And the more he wanted to train disciples, the more people began to admire him than to understand him. That was one of his complaints about the people of his own time. And he was rather impatient about the appreciations of people about him, because he was having a peculiar type of mental setup. It seems he thought that every hour and every minute of his life was valuable. And it seems he expected that people would make the best use of his span. And people began to admire him instead of trying to receive what he gave as wisdom. He grew impatient. And that may be one of the reasons why he became unpopular. Because as we normally see in the human mental setup, the masses appreciate those who have some weaknesses and defects. Because the mass expects some obligations with them. And whenever they see people who have no obligations with them, they feel a bit disappointed. And however great may be the wisdom they impart, and however value may be the knowledge they give to us, unless we find that the person has something to do with us, or unless he expects something from us, generally we are not very ready to appreciate for a long time. That is part of human nature in any century, and that is where the masses grow impatient with great people. As we understand the trend of life of Pythagoras, he had nothing to fall back upon anyone. And it seems he never appreciated any obligations with anyone. Whether it was happy or unhappy, he wanted to create what he wanted to create to his disciples. He was always on the giving pole and not the receiving pole. And added to this, he was impatient. And nothing hurts him than indiscipline. We can venture to put forth that he was not having that much of tolerance for the common multitudes, which is necessary to give some time for them to rectify themselves. In the language of the Alice A. Bailey, we can say that he was too much of the first ray on the intellectual plane, that he always of a bullying nature with his will. Of course, people could not very much tolerate it. But at the same time, he was having very great respect to everyone who met him. And it seems there was some gap of understanding between himself and others. He always worshipped the multitudes in his mind. And he always venerated individuals. And in preparing disciples also, he had only the spirit of veneration and worship, which the people could not very easily understand. Because when they are in the presence of such a great man, it is inevitable that people suffer from a little inferiority complex, especially when he began to honor the people and when he began to honor the disciples. Automatically, they used to feel some void in their confidence. And there was a little layer of gap in understanding. The more he honored the people, the more they misunderstood him. And they could not distinguish between his spirit of discipline and his attitude of honor. Because for many people, honoring means a compromise. That is, compromising one's own principles with the conveniences and inconveniences of others. In that way, generally people understand, and they could understand him also in that way. I think after he finished his discipline and spiritual training in Egypt, there was a period of gap before he reached once again Greece. It was during that period many people believe that he had been to the eastern countries also, especially India, Japan and China. And many legends are there to prove that he was touring in India, and also having a very intimate contact with many gurus in India, not only as a disciple of many, but also as a guru of many. He was having a high honor in India, because we have evidences as early as 200 years BC that his name was honored in Sanskrit also. In Sanskrit, it was interpreted like this: Pita and Guru. Pita means a place of transmitting wisdom, like a holy seminary place where a guru stays and disseminates wisdom. So his name is honored as Pita Guru in ancient India.
Comme étant Pita Guru.
And some Indian scholars even today believe that the name Pythagoras was not his original name, but it was a title which was given to him in Sanskrit to glorify him. So, about his stay in India and his the honor and glory he enjoyed in India, we have many stories. Not only that, the innermost secrets of Indian scriptures, which can be had only through the traditional gurus. For example, unless a teacher like Jalpul or Master Moria opens up some secrets of the Indian scriptures, it's not possible to receive what the texts actually mean. And a scholarly understanding of the scriptures is most often misleading and much misinterpreting.
Et donne une fausse interprétation.
But when we see the teachings of Pythagoras, they exactly contain the secrets which the ancient Indian scriptures contain. So we can say the very core of the Indian scriptures was given in many of his teachings. It may not be only Indian in those days. It may be the common wisdom of ancient India, Egypt and Greece, etc. Because there were centuries when the wisdom was common to many nations, and the centers of wisdom were in many nations transmitting to each other. So we can have no doubt in understanding that he is one among those who contain the secrets of the scriptures. I will give you an example of what they say, the Pythagorean decad. Now, there is one formula given by the disciples of Pythagoras by way of his initiation formula to his disciples. Now, many people give us this formula in the name of the decad. And there are authors who have written as many as 200 pages about the decad. Not explaining at all what the significance of the decad is. You can understand the top secrets of the scriptures imbibed in this formula. If you go into any one of the ancient Indian scriptures, you will find these numbers repeatedly given as the time keys for the events on this earth. For example, the historical periodicities and the repetitions of nations and races. If you add 10 to it, it gives us, according to the Indian scriptures, the periodicities of the floods of the various rivers on this earth globe. If you add 10, it gives the periodicities of the shifting of the islands in the ocean from place to place. For example, the shifting of the poles on this earth and the shifting of the equator causing stunning changes in the temperatures on this earth. Yeah. And at some places there will be erosions and earthquakes. At some places there will be the glaciers forming and the ocean gaining land in some places and new pieces of land making their appearance. If you add another 0, it gives us a period of what is called the great cycle. You double the number of that cycle, you will get another great cycle. You multiply the first cycle by 3, you will get another bigger cycle. And you will multiply the first number by 4, you will get a bigger cycle. Each cycle has its own separate application. The details of the application are given in the scriptures themselves. And when you make a total of these figures, you will have 1 unit, 2 units, 3 units and 4 units. The total being 10 units, you will have the same figures with one more zero. So the first period is what the esoteric books call Kali Yuga,
yeah,
or Kali Age. The second period is called Dwapara Yuga. Third period is called Treta Yuga. The fourth period is called Krita Yuga. This is the terminology of the scriptures. There are 18 scriptures in Sanskrit, each of which describe all these figures and their details also, and give us the keys as to how to apply these cycles. So, what Pythagoras meant was these cycles. That is what he meant by decade. There is a cryptic sentence in one of the scriptures. The personality of the cosmic consciousness comes down as the solar consciousness and then comes down as the planetary consciousness. And on this earth planet, it comes down as the human being after undergoing all the stages of evolution, and the whole process is said to be the evolution of the consciousness of the cosmic person, and the cosmic person is said to multiply by 10 digits. This is what the Indian scriptures describe. So the multiplication by 10 digits means so much of tradition and wisdom. And if you go into the details and the application of these cycles, you will understand that they occur in the reverse order. That is, the Krita Yuga occurs at first, and it is called the golden age in all the scriptures of all nations. After that, it is the Treta Yuga that occurs, and it is called the silver age. After that, the Dwapara Yuga occurs. It is called the copper age in all the scriptures. And the fourth will be Kali Yuga. It is called the age of iron. And after the four are completed, once again they repeat. Just as after Saturday we have once again Sunday. And also just as we have seasons in the year, and the effects of the seasons on the fauna and flora of this earth, we have these four seasons in the bigger cycle. Each cycle has its own seasonal effects upon the cycles, upon the psychology of the human race in general, and upon the evolutionary psychologies of the 7 races that exist on this earth, and also the century psychologies that change from time to time, and the type of logic that governs the human beings through ages. All these details are given in the scriptures. And when the total is completed, the total is called one great age. In Sanskrit it is called Mahayuga. Now we are in the present cycle, Kali Yuga. 5,000 years are completed, and the remaining is to be completed. Of course, there are subdivisions also. How to divide these things into minor cycles were also known to Pythagoras. That is what we understand when we study his calculation. You know, this whole formula is given in the form of the decade, and also in all the nations it is also given in the form of a glyph of one point, 2 points, 3 points and 4 points. That is in the same order. The words also indicate the same proportions and numbers. The word Kali in Sanskrit means unit. And Dwapara means twice. That is twice the unit. Sanskrit Treta means three times. So three times the original unit. And Krita means four times. So four times the original unit. This is called the glyph to meditate these cycles of time. Ancient Buddhists called it the Lord's head in the lotus, because they understood it as one petal of the lotus. And you have to imagine a lotus having 1,000 petals like this, in the center of which the Lord of great cycles exists. So he is called the Lord Manipadma. The formula is called also Manipadma. And to know the secrets of the cycles and to know the key to the prophecies, they also give the mantra Om Manipadmaya Hum. That is one of the great mantras of the ancient scriptures. That is one of the great mantras of the ancient scriptures. And ancient Indian tantric books, they give the same formula in the name of a deity called Dattatreya, the Lord of Yoga. It is said that he is having three heads on one neck. You might have seen some pictures also of Lord Dattatreya. A person, human figure standing, one neck and three heads, and four dogs walking along with the person. So the same formula is given in various symbolisms through thousands of years. Now we can understand the wisdom of Pythagoras. What he inculcated to his disciples and the types of initiations he has given to his disciples. And